This video is made possible by the free-to-play action game Crossout. Check out the game through the link in the description below, and you can start with 3 extra weapons or a vehicle cabin just for registering. More about them in a bit. In July of 1969, 5 decades ago and just 8 years after President Kennedy challenged the United States to land a man on the moon, Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin accomplished the task to international fanfare. They were, of course, just the tip of the sword here. The lunar landings were a massive accomplishment supported by an international network of communication stations and strategically located ships. It had required advancements in the preparation of food and the disposal of waste, the exact determination of contingencies beyond the ken or caring of most of humanity. It was a scientifically determined exercise, which required, at the end, the courage of 3 men strapped atop what was essentially just an enormous bomb. At the time, only a few unmanned vehicles had been dispatched to the moon, and more than a few had failed spectacularly. Scientists, engineers, mathematicians, cooks, tailors, technicians, administrators, politicians, and virtually every discipline known to humanity had contributed to the effort, striving to consider in advance every potential contingency and have in place the means to deal successfully with whatever event may arise. 50 years later, much of their efforts can be viewed as almost quaint, particularly when one compares the computing power of one's smartphone with that of the Lunar Excursion Module, which carried Armstrong and Aldrin to the surface of the moon and returned them to rendezvous with their colleague Michael Collins in lunar orbit. As with all of humanity's great leaps forward, there are many aspects little remembered, but which were a part of the event and the community which accomplished it. And in the video today, we're looking at a few of these. Number 10. NASA took steps to protect the Earth from moon germs, but they weren't foolproof. Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin were the only 2 men of Apollo 11 to walk on the moon, but upon their return to the mission's command module, they were reunited with fellow astronaut Michael Collins. Thus, it was determined, by whomever determined such things, that all 3 astronauts could have been exposed to unknown microorganisms while on their journey, and it was a wise precaution to isolate the 3 astronauts from the rest of the human race upon their return to Earth, at least for a short time. Accordingly, NASA constructed a mobile quarantine facility, MQF, to house the 3 upon their return, and it was waiting for them aboard the USS Hornet. It was essentially an Airstream trailer which had been properly modified. Since they had made contact with other humans as part of exiting the spacecraft floating merrily in the Pacific, those potentially contaminated workers joined them in the trailer. Within the confines of the Airstream, which was actually built by Airstream, the 3 astronauts were seen via television chatting with American President Richard Nixon. What the public did not see was that the astronauts and those recovery personnel isolated with them were doing what many vacationers did when temporarily residing in their airstreams. They were enjoying martinis. Perhaps it was the alcohol which stymied lunar pathogens, or perhaps it was just a bit of overcaution on the part of NASA officials. But after 3 weeks, the quarantined men were allowed to return to the life of the living, having exhibited no ill effects caused by moon germs. We should also note that not all the time was spent in the airstream. They were transferred to a larger isolation facility after being flown to Houston. After Apollo 14, the Apollo 13 astronauts were not quarantined, having never reached the moon. Isolating the astronauts upon return was deemed to be unnecessary. Number 9. A piece from the Wright Brothers airplane was carried to the moon by Neil Armstrong. Humanity first achieved powered, heavier-than-air flight in December of 1903 when Wilbur and Orville Wright launched their flyer into the air at Kitty Hawk, North Carolina. Less than 66 years later, the first man walked upon the surface of the moon. Millions of people who were alive when the first flight was accomplished were still alive to see men on the moon. Neil Armstrong, like the Wrights, was an Ohioan, and it was his decision to take to the moon with him a tribute to the men who had not only achieved the first flight, but had developed the principles of control which still determine the ability to fly. To do so, he enlisted the help of the Museum of the United States Air Force, also located in Ohio, and obtained pieces of the Wright flyer, one of muslin fabric from the left wing of the aircraft, the other a piece of wood from the left propeller. Armstrong took advantage of an authorized piece of equipment carried by astronauts known as the PPK, NASA speak for the personal preference kit. Basically, it was a purse made of Teflon-coated fabric and roughly the size of a standard lunchbox. The space travelers were limited to 5 pounds or less of personal items, which they were allowed to carry to the moon and back. While no one knows what else Armstrong took to the moon with him, the pieces of the flyer which went to the moon were brought back with him. Both of these things are now in the possession of the Smithsonian. Number 8. The Apollo program missions were a massive undertaking in terms of the numbers of men and women working to support them. It is difficult to accurately estimate the number of people who directly supported the Apollo program and its accomplishments of landing Americans on the moon. Earlier programs, from which some workers had already retired, were essential to the success of Apollo, though they are not usually counted. By the time of the launch of Apollo 11 in July of 1969, NASA had already been subjected to cutbacks in other programs. The United States military also provided active duty personnel, particularly the US Navy, whose ships provided the recovery vessels for retrieving returning astronauts and their spacecraft. Other military organizations used the Apollo missions and other space missions to hone their missile tracking skills as part of their continuous training towards stymieing the Soviets during the ongoing Cold War. So a true number is somewhat difficult to pin down when counting those who made Apollo a success. At least 400,000 men and women were directly involved in the successful landing on the moon. Whether this number considers those who were tangentially involved, such as those who prepared the recipe for a space dinner, is debated. Regardless, the effort was truly a national one, involving contractors and subcontractors from virtually every American state. President Kennedy had exhorted, "This nation should commit itself to achieving the goal," and the nation responded in a manner not seen since the industrial buildup during the Second World War, and unfortunately, not seen since. Each Apollo space mission, including all of the components of the boosters and the Apollo system itself, comprised of over 5.5 million individual parts, any of which could have led to a catastrophic failure and the loss of the lives of the three men who rode the system into space. Number 7. Astronauts returning from the moon signed customs forms asserting items to declare. When Apollo 11 returns from the moon, in the form of the three astronauts in the command module, the rest of the equipment remained in space or on the moon, the astronauts were treated to the trappings common to heroes in American tradition. They were visited by the President of the United States, they were interviewed by the press, radio, and television, they were given ticker tape parades and the keys to the city by American towns. Streets were renamed in their honor, later so were schools, parks, museums, highways, and other sites. But before enjoying any of the perks derived from their mission, they were subjected to the bureaucratic nonsense which is all too often a part of modern life. This, of course, happened after their period of isolation in the airstream. The first men to return from the moon returned to US territory via the deck of the aircraft carrier USS Hornet. From there, they were flown, ensconced in their airstream, to Honolulu, then Houston, where they entered the more spacious isolation facility. While in Honolulu, they filled customs forms claiming that they were re-entering the United States with items to declare to customs. The items were dust and rocks collected from the lunar surface. They also had to state, as all international travelers do, their travel itinerary, and they described it as being from Cape Kennedy to Honolulu with a stopover on the moon. All three astronauts signed the form, declaring it to be complete, exact, and true, as if they could have possibly deviated, having just completed what was the most closely monitored trip of all time. Number 6. The Apollo 11 astronauts were among the most closely watched television personnel in history. Apollo 11 provided some of the most dramatic television scenes in history, presented by the astronauts themselves as they continued on their journey and emphasized by network personnel hosting the broadcasts. Walter Cronkite, an unabashed fan of the American space program, spent hours explaining events as the mission wound on, and his competitors at other networks did the same. Regularly scheduled television broadcasts were bumped to allow events from space to be viewed by the American public, who were paying for them through their taxes, as well as by the rest of the world. When Neil Armstrong stepped down the ladder of the lunar excursion module, named Eagle, by the astronauts, it was seen on live television. Him taking those first steps on the moon is undoubtedly some of the most dramatic footage ever created. It should be no surprise to learn, then, that the broadcast prepared by NASA and the astronauts engaged on the space mission should be the recipient of an Emmy Award. But it went to the astronauts of an earlier Apollo mission, Apollo 7, in October of 1968. Apollo 7 never left Earth orbit, as the astronauts went on an 11-day mission which tested the components of the program's command module. Astronauts Wally Shearer, Don Eisel, and Walter Cunningham were awarded a special Emmy Award that year for their nightly broadcasts of what came to be known as the Wally, Walt, and Don Show. During this program, they demonstrated eating in space and other daily evolutions. Later, Shearer revealed that he had wanted to televise astronauts using the relief tube to answer the call of nature while in orbit, but his bosses in Houston demurred. So just before we get into the top 5 today, I do want to take a minute to tell you about today's sponsor, Crossout. Now, you are going to be able to build something that will take you to the moon in Crossout, but in terms of video games with creative vehicle building freedom, Crossout is as good as it gets. Crossout is an online vehicle action game where all of the vehicles are made by the players. Basically, what you do is you construct your own crazy vehicle from the ground up with all sorts of different parts. You can add weapons, support systems, the main structure, and then a bunch else to your vehicles, from railguns to rocket boosters. Basically, you make your own incredible vehicle, and then you use it to destroy other people's. It's a super fast-paced game with loads of different game modes, and you've pretty much got limitless freedom to create. And what you do with your vehicle, it's entirely up to you. And it's not a complicated game right at the start, with there being a very easy learning curve, allowing you to make your own vehicle and just get jumping into the game really quickly. Loads of different game modes as well, so you're sure to find one that you love. Join us on the battlefield for free, by the way, using the link in the description below. You can play on PC, Xbox One, or PlayStation 4. It's all very easy. Also, going through that link not only helps support this show, it's a great free way for you to do that, but you can also get a free starter set with 3 extra weapons or a vehicle cabin, and that's all just as a bonus for registering. Thanks to Crossout for sponsoring, and let's get into those top 5. Number 5. When astronauts needed clothes which moved with them, a bra manufacturer came to the rescue. As early as 1962, NASA was evaluating and testing spacesuits to be worn by the Apollo astronauts, cognizant of the fact that, unlike suits to be worn only within the confines of the space capsule, the Apollo astronauts would require better range of motion and comfort. Of particular concern were the suits to be worn by the astronauts on the surface of the moon. 2 companies led the bidding process to produce the Apollo suits, International Latex Corporation and Hamilton Standard. Hamilton tried to muscle ILC out of the process, but Hamilton's spacesuits failed to make the grades that was required by NASA, with a great deal of criticism coming from the astronauts themselves. The astronauts were heavily involved in all aspects of crew comfort and safety throughout the manned space program. ILC became the lead developer and manufacturer of spacesuits, a position it retains in the 21st century, by the way. ILC is better known by its current name, Playtex. In 1962, it was a subsidiary of Playtex, known primarily as a manufacturer of 2 types of women's undergarments, brassieres and girdles. Although girdles are all but unknown in current women's fashions, in 1962 they were still considered a foundation to the lingerie industry. The suit produced for the Apollo astronauts weighed just over 100 pounds minus the astronaut, and when the latter and his support pack were included, the total was around 500 pounds, depending, of course, on the weight of the astronaut. It is a little known fact that at the same time the women's liberation movement was beginning to exhort their sisters to burn their bras, a suit designed and made by a bra manufacturer was preventing astronauts from being burned up in space. By the way, as of 2019, Playtex no longer manufactures girdles, preferring to concentrate on something called shapingwear. Number 4. Some of the astronauts carried contraband to the moon. America's astronauts had an established history of smuggling unauthorized objects into space with them, to the everlasting frustration of their Earthbound bosses. John Young once flew into space on Gemini 3, taking along a corned beef sandwich, mostly as a joke on his traveling companion Gus Grissom. Both astronauts took bites from the sandwich before concerns over errant crumbs forced Young to return it to his pocket. The incident drew debate in the House of Representatives and other political posturing, and drew Young a reprimand. However, according to Young, it was neither the first nor the last sandwich to be smuggled into space by astronauts, less than enthralled with the NASA-prepared official cuisine available. Alan Shepard took smuggling contraband a step further. He took along a golf club on his journey to the moon. Specifically, he took the head of a 6-iron, specially modified by an accomplice, a Houston golf pro named Jack Harden, to fit an authorized piece of equipment to serve as a shaft. In the manner of golfers everywhere, Shepard also smuggled along golf balls with great secrecy, enabling him to play while his spouse thought he was at work. While on the lunar surface, Shepard took out the clubs and balls and became the only man to hit a golf ball thus far while standing on the moon. According to Shepard, he shanked the first shot. On his mulligan, he hit the ball flush and it went at least 200 yards. Nice distance for a one-handed shot while wrapped in an over 100-pound Playtex suit. The United States Golf Association Museum in New Jersey has the modified 6-iron donated to it by Shepard at the suggestion of Bing Crosby. The balls still lie on the surface of the moon. Shepard never revealed to the world what brand they are. Number 3. Communion has been taken, but not served, on the surface of the moon. The second man to set foot on the surface of the moon was Edwin E. Aldrin, known to his fellow astronauts as Buzz. Aldrin was, in addition to being a veteran combat pilot, the first astronaut to hold a PhD, and a veteran of walking in space, also an elder at Webster Presbyterian Church. While on the surface of the moon, and while awaiting his commander's first steps on the lunar surface, Aldrin took communion, an event witnessed by a respectful Neil Armstrong, who did not participate. Aldrin took communion in the form of both water and wine, with the foreknowledge of mission controllers on the ground. The event was kept from the media at the time, since NASA was already involved in a lawsuit regarding the astronauts having read from the Bible during the mission of Apollo 8 on Christmas Eve 1968, an event broadcast to Earth on television. Aldrin used a communion kit which had been presented to him by the pastor of his
church. He poured the communion wine into a vessel and reported on the qualities it displayed in the severely lower gravity as a matter of scientific observation. Many years later, in 2009, Aldrin reflected that had he had the opportunity to repeat his act, he would not do so, since the rite was a Christian one and thus not reflective of the mission's self-stated intent to be for all mankind. There are other examples of astronauts taking part in religious rites while deployed in space, particularly on the space shuttle missions and while serving aboard the International Space Station, but Aldrin's communion is the only such act to have been performed on the surface of the moon. Number 2. Humanity has left tons of trash and refuse on the surface of the moon. For the most part, the moon and Las Vegas have in common that what happens there stays there. There have been 6 manned moon missions, all completed by the United States. 12 men, all Americans, have trod upon the lunar surface. No man has ever gone back. Nearly all the equipment taken to the moon by the missions it was left behind. In return for the soil sample and rocks which Americans took from the lunar surface, they left behind cameras, flags, shovels, and other small tools, as well as the bases of the 6 lunar modules. There are also the lunar excursion vehicles and a host of other detritus. At least one bird feather remains there from a falcon, as well as a hammer. These 2 items were used in an experiment mirroring those of Galileo and then left to lay. The Apollo missions aren't the only source of man-made detritus on the moon. Many unmanned space missions which reached the moon are, of course, still there. Some of them Soviet property, making America not the only Earthbound nation to litter the moon. Most estimates are that there are upwards of 400,000 pounds of Earth-made trash lying around, waiting for the next lunar explorer to encounter. In fact, there is so much trash on the moon that missions to recover some of it have been proposed as a means of studying the long-term impacts of radiation and the lunar environment on man-made materials. The NASA History Program Office maintains an inventory of items known to have been abandoned or lost on the moon, and it's visible online. Among the items listed is a gold olive branch, and a bit lower on the same page, a defecation collection device. Number 1. Armstrong and Aldrin both claimed they could smell the lunar surface. Beginning with Armstrong and Aldrin, and confirmed by subsequent lunar explorers unanimously, the surface of the moon has a unique but readily noticeable smell. First noticed by Apollo 11 astronauts at the end of their first stroll around Tranquility Base, as they named the landing site, in July of 1969, it remained a subject of discussion among the small fraternity of men who have seen the Earth while standing on the moon. The astronauts all noticed the smell upon repressurizing the cabin of the lunar module, allowing them to remove their helmets. Dust and other residue present on their boots, suits, and gloves gave off the smell, which several likened to gunpowder. An interesting phenomenon is that the smell is not detected emanating from lunar samples examined back on Earth. It was only present in the lunar module shortly after completion of repressurization. While all of the astronauts who walked on the moon agreed to the existence of the smell and its similarity to the odor of gunpowder, none have ever agreed to explanations of what the smell was or why it was not replicated when examining samples on Earth. But the smell was bothersome at the time, as some scientists believed that lunar dust collected by the astronauts could spontaneously combust when exposed to oxygen, a worry not lost on Armstrong and Aldrin. Armstrong collected a handful of dust while on the moon, depositing it in his pocket rather than in a sample bag, and placed it on a flat surface while the LEM was repressurized for the first time, ready to act should the sample begin to smolder. It did not, and the 2 astronauts returned to Earth. The strange smell of the moon is a mystery which began rather than ended with man's first trip to the moon. So I really hope you found that video interesting. If you did, please do hit that thumbs up button below, and don't forget to subscribe. Brand new videos just like this every day of the week. For more from me, why not check out some videos from the archives linked to on the screen. And as always, thank you for watching.